Hello there, my name's Madak.
Howdy, traveler. Need a crab to Onu-Koro? Awful dark in there, but Poku knows the way. I heard there's another Uso race coming up. Make sure you catch it if you're in town.
What race?
The Uso crabs are strong and loyal. They help us with many things here, from mining to transportation, but mostly racing. I'm usually at the track, but with all the problems these days, there isn't much time for it.
Who's Poku?
Poku's a retired racing crab. He used to belong to none other than Onepu himself. Took the tie 3 times with him. She's a bit long in the tooth now, but still fast.
What is Onu-Koro?
Onu-Koro is the great undercity of Onuwahi, where the mine sink as deep as Mount Ahu is tall. The wise Wenua rules there.
Goodbye.
Bye now.
Madak is one of my favorite Bionicle characters. Someday they're gonna name a gun after him. I'm just fucking throwing that out there. Yeah, basically, he's the odd man out of the Onomotor, and most of them live underground, but he got one look at the sun one day as they broke through this tunnel, and he just never wanted to go back in. He loved it out here in the open sun so much, he just wanted to sit out here and stare at it all day. And they needed someone to manage these taxi crabs going in and out, so seemed like the perfect man for the job, apparently. Anyway, this crab right here is another one of those models. Not exactly, but yeah, it's part of that 15-in-1 set. We're gonna take her in. Ride the crab? Sure. Whee! And now we are at the heart of Matanui. The greatest city in all the... Yeah. We'll get into it as we go on.
You there, fetch those saddles. We need more discs. Step to it. Try to stay out of the way, traveler. We're organizing a patrol. With all lights out on the car, the Rahi has stepped up their raids. Take care when traveling the deep mines and tunnels. The Kofu Jaga can appear at any time. Battling them takes special skill.
What are Kofu Jaga?
They're small creatures, but incredibly fierce and cunning. They attack by surprise, and always in large numbers. They shun bright light and use darkness and fear as their weapons. Their nests are scattered throughout the underworld, and woe betide the miner who breaks through to one. Usually, Wenua uses a special drill to detect these nests before they're opened, but he's been too busy, and the miners have been desperate to find more protodermis veins.
How do I battle the Kofu Jaga?
The regiment depends on its gallant steeds and a healthy supply of discs when fighting the Kofu Jaga. The darkness gives the Makuta's minion strength. It's good to have a lightstone with you if you can find one.
So, who are you?
Onepu at your service. I'm the captain of the famous Onomotor and Yosobi Regiment, champion of Yoso Racing, and special aid of Wenua, our great Turaga.
Yeah, I've never known how you're supposed to pronounce it. Is it Yoso? Is it Usul? Probably guess so. Anyway, meet Onepu. He's another one of those guys from the Happy Meals. And, you know, it's perfect that he's one of the first guys that you meet when coming to Onu-Koro. By the way, before I...
May your crab ride swift and true!
Yes, you just heard someone say that. Anyway... That's just too cute. Anyway, oh, I love this. Watch. I love that. Even the guys who don't talk to you, even the guys who aren't really NPCs, they still interact with you in some way. It's just, it's sweet. Anyway, remember that rock back in Powahi? Yeah, I just recently found out it says, my friends went to Powahi, and all I got was a stupid rock. Amazing, Templar Studios. Anyway, yeah, this place, it isn't quite as lively as the other villages. Well, actually, none of the villages we've been to lately have been particularly lively until we solved all their problems. And, you know, Madak did say that this place was having troubles, so... Yeah, the candles are a dead giveaway. Won't explain how for a little bit, but you'll see. Oh, here's some merchants from other villages.
Statues, souvenirs, excellent Pulmatorn craftsmanship. Fresh fish imported from Gakko, get your fresh fish here.
I'm sorry, I find the idea of a female character who's all dainty and everything speaking like that adorable. It's like Harley Quinn or something.
Torches, don't be left in the dark, Tamatoran maid!
And apparently those are the torches we're seeing everywhere. Why can't these people light up these caves on their own? Well, you'll see. I'll talk to these guys for now. I'll just leave him for later. So yeah, you may have noticed we can't talk to him just yet because he's too preoccupied with these guys.
Turago Inua, I will not tolerate this kind of delay. The trade guilds have contracts with Poa for a Poa Carl's most influential artist.
I understand that, and I'm doing everything I can.
Purodermis production is stopped. Stone masons are slowed by the darkness, and half the shipments were lost to Rahi attacks.
Tarmatoran torches were being used to light the stone quarries now. Those deliveries will be made.
The Kofujug are not afraid of torchlight. And what are the Protodermis? The Pomatoran cannot trade stone for nothing.
The mine captains are working to break through this rock layer. Until then, there is little we can do.
They make goods from the Protodermis. Without it, they cannot trade for... We cannot trade for...
I'm sorry.
We will lose that market.
There are other markets.
And what of the Le-Koro Highway? It was to be finished months ago. My caravans refuse to travel to the south until it is complete.
The Lamatoran will have to come trade at our market until it is finished. They try, Turaga, but they can no more come north than we can go south. Perhaps the sea is a better route.
They're even more dangerous, Rahi, in the waters than on the land. What of Onua? Is he doing nothing to help Onu-Koro?
Onua did not descend from the heavens to help your prophet, Skillmaster. He is pursuing a great quest that may yet save us all.
I demand that more attention be paid to the needs of the trade guilds. The great market is Onu-Koro's most valuable asset.
Skillmaster, I will speak with Onepu. Perhaps he can spare an escort for your caverns and caravans until the highway is complete.
So, yeah. Then that just loops for a while. This guy's a kettle on his head. That's just great. Apparently he's too lazy to just carry one in his hands.
Without a fresh supply of light stones, we cannot light the digging site.
Have you been able to continue the tunneling at all?
Yes, but we're working at about 25% capacity. It is too dark down there to work safely.
The Le-Koro Highway must be completed soon.
I'm sorry, my voice is too clear. I need to make it all garbly so it sounds like that guy a lot.
We need safe passages between the villages.
Turaga, we cannot ask our workers to continue under these conditions.
Teipu says he can dig by torchlight without difficulty.
Teipu is very stubborn and strong, but he is slow even when he has a team of diggers to help him. One Matori cannot dig a tunnel to Le-Koro.
Foreman, until we can repair the flood damage, there is little I can do.
You can give us more Matori and more equipment. The guilds and the traders have extra. We can use those.
They do not have extra. How would it help if they did?
The air is bad because of the torches, and the Rahi attack frequently because of the darkness. If we had more workers, we could alternate teams before they get ill. We could put more guards on duty.
Foreman, I understand the problems you are facing. I am doing everything in my power to get you the help you need, but you must be patient.
Without a first...
Wait. Okay, yeah, so that just loops too. So yeah, the Onomatoran are some of the most industrious people on the entire island. They build highways connecting all the different villages through this one hub, and they mine various materials that are, you know, shipped out in, well, of course, so that they keep a chunk for themselves, but all in all, this really is the heart of the island. This is the heart of the Matoran civilization. None of the other villagers would even, like, have an efficient means of communicating without these guys here. Anyway. Does he wave too? Yes, he does! So yeah, Onu-Ta-Le-Koro. So this connects to all of these places. Let's see, here we are now. There's Le-Koro. There's Ta-Koro. We can tell because it's a fiery symbol. This is supposed to look like a gust of wind. And that's Lightstone Cache. We'll get into those as we go on. Anyway, yeah, when we rode the crab in here, it actually would have been quicker to just keep on clicking on these again and again and again and again. Look at how fast we're already here. But it was just fun to see the little animation. I'm gonna stop by here real quick. So, like I said earlier, Pokoro is way up north. Le-Koro is way down south at the other end of the island, and that's where these guys are trying to go. Let's see. You can't dig what you can't see. No can see, no can dig. You guys should be ashamed. Yeah, I get they're on hard times, they're under-equipped, they don't have the means to finish the job, but at least this guy's trying. Look at what he's doing all by himself. Least he could do is help him, but whatever. Let's talk to this guy. love this music.
It's hard to dig when there...
Wait, what kind of voice should I give him?
It's hard to dig when there's no light, but Onipu says I have to try. Someday we will reach Le-Koro. If the Rai attack the Sight Travelers, stay near me. I'll protect you.
Why are you digging?
We're building a highway to the village of Le-Koro. Manua says I'm the strongest of the Onu-Koro, so I'm leading the way.
Who's Onipu?
Onipu is my best friend in all of Onu-Koro. He's very smart, knows a lot about also crab racing and fighting Rai. He's supposed to be digging too, but he's shown me how I can do both of our digging at the same time. That's how smart he is.
Oh, you poor thing. What is Le-Koro?
It's a village in the south where the Le-Matoran live in the trees. I've never been there. Onipu says there are tall, pretty forests and huts built in the sky. Onipu says the Le-Matoran are great musicians too, and play music all day long from the treetops.
So, yeah. Taipu is another one of my favorite characters. He is just such a sweetheart. They talk about him like he's supposed to be a dummy or something, like Ed from Ed and Eddy, but he's just such a sweetheart. And yeah, he's doing all this by himself. He doesn't even care that these guys are abandoning him, basically. You guys. Well, let's make things just a little easier for them. You may have noticed, like, every now and then when I click on a new place to go to, you'll see this icon pop up. It's basically the island. Like, look. Yeah, back in the day on older computers that were slower and needed more time to load this up, it would fill up like this. Doop, boop, 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 boop. Like a clock or something. And it just kept going and going, and it would often take like 10 or 15 seconds. So if you were playing this on a really old computer, like a Windows 95 computer or whatever, you spent an awful lot of time looking at that screen.
We lost a bunch of drilling equipment when the float burst. So I was stuck on the other side of the fire lake. If only we could get across. Better steer clear of the area, traveler. There's a runaway lava flow that burst from Takaro. No way to get to the lightstone mines until it's rerouted.
Well, if we just keep going this way, the lava has to come from somewhere. And bam. We're back at Takaro. Just like that, we basically did a massive loop around the island. Let's see. There he is.
Hey, here's the lava surfboard you asked me to hang on to.
Thank you. So yeah, that's the lava board we lost. Well, no time to stay here and chit-chat. Back to Onu-Koro. Onuwahi is like one of the most expansive areas of all the island, because it isn't just one little place, it like stretches to all these corners of it. It's fascinating to me. Bionicle, like, just this island, Matanui, would not be nearly as interesting if Onuwahi wasn't there. I love this. Here we go. Whoa, that was odd.
Whee!
Now this game right here, this could take a while depending on if you know how to, whether you know how to do it. Basically, look, you see, when you click on one, it makes the others around it in a plus sign light up. So, yeah, and then it has the opposite effect on ones that are already lit. So you just keep doing it in a certain order, and you'll get it eventually. Sometimes I get it done in just a couple moves, sometimes it takes me Dang. I'll figure it out. Really, sometimes I've solved this in like two moves. But it's like the forest, it's just another one of those things that can take a long time depending on how you handle it. I don't know where I'm going with this. Dang it! Again! Just one more left of the... There we go. There are like a zillion ways you could solve that. It's just kind of tricky. Eddie waves too. Again, I love that. This game has so much personality. So many little things they didn't have to do, but they did. Man, just look at this. Isn't this just beautiful? Hey, see, this is what the Onomatoran rely on to light up the place. They don't like using torches. They use these light stones. They never die out. They don't have to be refueled. Nothing's burning. They're just these wonderful glowing stones. The light stone deposits in this cave will keep Onu-Koro lit for a long time. Pretty sure they'll keep the Rahi back too. Great work, stranger. There's a lot of folks in Onu-Koro who will be glad you found a way to the light stones. Hey, no problem, guy. So, let's see how Teipu's doing. Ah, now these guys don't have a problem working. Yes, the light stones are everywhere. This is how it should be.
Onipo told me you found a way to the light stones. Thank you. No, wait. What kind of voice did I give him?
Onipo told me you found a way to the light stones. Thank you, adventure. We can dig much more quickly now. I'm sure the highway will reach Le-Koro soon.
If they're right, you attack that. Okay.
Yeah, all right. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
And just like that, we've uncovered a whole new part of the island.
We did it! We made it through! Onipo was right. It's so beautiful here.
Onipo said I should make camp when we break through, but I want to go see Le-Koro and the Trematorn.
Le-Koro is right through those trees, I bet. Won't you take me with you to see it?
Yes, I will take you, Teipu.
Thank you. I bet it's more beautiful than the Great Mine. Let's go.
I almost never say no to Teipu. I almost always bring him along. Just, you know, why not? He's a good guy.
Never seen so many pretty plants.
Just his enthusiasm and his desire to explore the world. I mean, it's all you're doing, right? Why shouldn't he be able to do the same? Just don't stray too far ahead, little guy.
I wonder what the people of Le-Koro are.
Now, by this point, you can tell that the artists were just having a blast, just spattering and etching all this stuff. It's just beautiful.
Hey, it's here, Le-Koro, I found it's beautiful!
Teipu! Well, nothing we can do about that, I guess. Ah, this is so beautiful. Oh, I didn't even have to do that minigame. Huh, must have been a bug. I haven't even finished exploring Onu-Koro yet, and we're already up here, like in the completely opposite sort of place. And this has to be the most quiet dead village we've seen so far. Ugh. This is one of my favorite parts of the island. I just love how colorful it is, and just the idea of these people who have suspended an entire town in the treetops. That they're small and light enough, and their patchwork huts are light enough that they can just stay up here. Yay! And it's another Happy Meal guy. Another Mictoran, as people call them. Let's talk to him first.
Forgive, but village attacked by Makuta's evil beasts. Feared you were Rahi, but no, I'm a place flute like that. So down tree we come and greet. You are a brave wanderer that some speak of. Braver still for coming to Le-Koro.
We gained some reputation for ourselves here. Well, not every Matoran can just wander around the island having adventures and all that stuff. Like, I brought another guy with me and he got snatched away just seconds after coming outside. Who are you?
Tomorrow with Le-Koro, High Fly Vinesman, Deepwood Wayfinder, Chief Kahu Tamer, Matau's Best.
I didn't need to hear your whole life story, but okay. Let's see. What is Arama?
Nui Rama, Buzz Flying Rahi, Hundred Eye All Seeing Fright and Fury, Makuta Madness makes even worse. Wings smash, pincers grab, no chance for Matoran alone. Only Toa bold enough to stand against it, yet cunning Rama sneaks, whoop, smash, and fly out of reach.
So, yeah, what attack?
In last rainfall, Kongu on patrol saw Rama hive growing top leaf high, far in dark forest. Late knowing Matoran, Rama infected by Makuta. One drift to go, cloud sneaking Nui Rama fly on Le-Koro to destroy all. Quick soaring cow riders, tree launch, and great battles fought. Village still stands, but many lost.
Yeah, the Le-Matoran, they have a very musical way of speaking. They'll often slap like two words together, and it's just a funny little quirk about that. You know, it's just another one of those things that's endearing.
The forest can protect you, traveler, if you heed it.
Traveler, be... Wait, no, what did he sound like in the second Bionicle movie?
Travel, beware, the dark day come, my tail stolen, they were gone, and the Majorans were prepared for battle flight.
Sorry, I'll stop talking in that voice. It's just really, in the movie that this guy appeared in, the second movie, they gave him the most pitiful sounding voice you could imagine. Nothing like how I imagined him sounding when I first saw him in this game. For shame. Anyway,
Le-Matoran, prepare for battle flight.
Are you here to help in the defense, traveler? Le-Koro needs brave wind riders to face the Rama.
Who are you?
Kongu, fastest leaf runner, ever quick pilot, weaver, map maker, Le-Koro Matoran.
Impressive. Who's Matau?
Matau singer. Down talk, up singing, friend and laughter. In lifetime years past, was known Matau Kiwa champion. Matau, great Turaga of Le-Koro and soul of the forest people. Gone, gone, taken by Makuta's Rahi.
Who's Lewa?
Lewa, great toe of air, hero of Le-Koro, gone away in quest for the great Kanohi. If he were here, he would save us, for he has faced greater dangers than this and survived.
All right, bye-bye.
Up tree daddle, down tree peace. You choose, but if Rama come, try to stay undercover.
So yeah, I'm sorry that I use all these silly voices and whatnot, but you know, I can't help wanting to read every little thing about this game. I want you guys to see everything about this game. And I know these episodes are really long, but I do what I can with the editing and the voices and whatnot to at least add some character to them. Anyway, there's not much else for us to do here, so... apparently there is!
Rama storm! Scramble! Doink!
And those vultures are another one of the little models. This guy isn't, though. This is what you get when you combine two of those scorpions. And it was one of my favorite combiner models. I played with the scorpions on their own, but then I joined them into this thing and I just loved it. And I never took it apart. But I don't have it anymore. I don't know what the hell happened to it. Oh well. Anyway, this is the... Yeah, we can't even go anywhere now. We're stuck here. This is... Oh, poor Temaru. He's trying to climb on top of one of these, but he can't. Won't let him. Anyway, this is that point where this simple point-and-click game, this flimsy kids game, as some would call it, became an adventure. Prepare to be amazed by this awesome, awesome minigame.
Traveler, will you be my second? My cow stays tree-bound without a disc thrower.
Yes.
I hope your disc arm is as strong as your nerve. Lewa, protect us. Let's go!
Flight of the Valkyries. This really, really cheesy remixed version, as you'll hear. I love it. Stupid as heck, but I love it. Anyway, this is amazing, what you're about to see.
Break formation, but back up your wingmen. May the wind be ever under your wings.
This blew my mind when I was a kid. This version of it is a little buggy because now all of these bugs appear from the left side only most of the time, which is really, really strange. But it's still pretty hard because this is going really fast. Now basically, if they scratch you up a few times, you'll crash and you'll have to start the whole thing all over again, which wasn't so much a problem when this was only happening half as quickly on older computers. But like the cutscenes on more recent computers, in this day and age, it just whooshes by really fast, because it plays kind of like an interactive cutscene. That was a good hit. He smacked right on me like a bug on a windshield. That's hilarious. Now, the idea is that you're supposed to conserve your disc to be really careful to not to run out, but it only takes like a second to reload. So I just unload them all at once when a ROM is around and just reload when they're not nearby. Eek. I love this sequence. This is beautiful. This is that point where this game became like downright impressive. Like really, who expected to see something like this when they bought these toys? Something this amazing where you're flying through the clouds and over the clouds and the music keeps changing to fit the tone and ooh. We're very close to the hive now. It's so stupid. Oh, jeez, I can only take like one more hit. But it's okay, this next part, it shouldn't be too hard to avoid. They don't come up in that one same motion, but it's easier to aim at them because you can see them coming from far away. Oh, I love this bit. Ah, just barely made it. If that had gone on like another second, it would have played the cutscene where you crash and have to start the whole thing all over again. Good take. This is gonna make up for all the time I spent. Yeah, anyway. Ah, oh, Teipu. Just doing what he does best. There's the Taraga of this village. This is such a cool sequence, really. This is one of the highlights of this game right here. This is one of the most... Ooh! That green... Yeah, no way one of those bugs could have taken us down, like, in one swipe. I mean, yeah, we were on our last legs and at the end of that little minigame, but in the cutscene... Wait, must have been something really tough. Yeah, look at this place! I was amazed when I first saw this, because... I couldn't have expected to go to a place like this. It's just, this is so creative, so imaginative. Apparently, they're forcing the Matoran to mine underground and try to reach the other villages, probably so these things can just spread everywhere and invade the island. It is just crazy. If I were able to remake this game for the PS4 or something, I would make this place its own level. And I would have the bird crash some distance away from all these guys. So you'd have to, like, crawl through trenches and other such creepy places while all these things were buzzing above you and the music would sound like insects buzzing and so on. Yeah. Oh well, even as just the single screen that it is, it's still one of those just really memorable sorts of places. That beetle is another one of the models. Anyway. Little typo. Let's talk to Matao, as he's called. Just for fun, I think that a perfect voice for this guy, given what he sounded like when he was younger in the movies, would be Mike Pollock. That's just me.
It's an honor that you sought to save me, traveler, but I'm sorry that you made the attempt. But with song you will know hope, and hope brings freedom. Keep your voice down, traveler, and sing as you work. I'd hope Lewa comes to save us.
Who are you?
I am Matao, called the Singer by the people of Le-Koro. I am their Taraga. I have been in prison here since Leaf Dawn.
Will Lewa come to save us?
You are not of this tribe, so I will tell you of Lewa. But you must swear not to reveal what I'm about to say to anyone. Lewa is here, but he will not save us. The great Toa is the same in body and strength and in speed, but his mind is gone. He has been attacked by the Makuta and enslaved by evil. His great mask of power has been replaced with an infected mask, and the only way to bring him back is to take it off. And I know of nothing with the strength to overcome him. He has become more fearsome and horrible than any Rahi. We shall never escape this place. All that is left to us is song, and what small comfort it brings.
Goodbye.
Take care, and do your work without resistance. Nui Rama are not clever, but they see much. They know when we are plotting.
So, I guess this is it, guys. This is where I'll be spending the rest of my life. You know, it's not so bad. I got a friend, and these guys all seem pretty cool. Oh, I guess that's that. Ooh! This animation right here is so cool. Like I said, it plays super fast, but I think that just makes the action even better. Well, actually not really. Kind of makes it hard to keep up with. But there it is. There's like the queen of the Nui Rama. And then, it's Anua! Hooray! Two Toa fighting. When I was a kid, this just blew my mind. Like everything else in this game, as I've been saying, this is just so cool.
What was happening to me? My body, now my own, my mind, get out of my mind!
This is the power of Makuta.
These animations here are kind of random. They're pretty fun to watch. There we go. We're getting a little of everything in this cutscene. This was a good take. The use of the masks, just the choreography and everything is really creative in this scene. This was just so cool. That's the mask I'm talking about. Oh, they forgot to draw his head.
His mask! Get his mask!
Yoink! Yes! Isn't he just beautiful? Mask of Mind Control! Like a Taipu dancing. This is so great. Hey, just look at this. This is what it's all about. This makes it all worth it. See how amazing this game is? Like, yeah, the mechanics and whatnot, but it might be not be the most innovative or whatever, and it is just a series of mini-games and just talking to a bunch of random cyborg people. But just the personality of this game, just the impression it leaves on you, the mark it leaves on you, it's just so enjoyable. It's crazy. He's like, hey, I'm sorry, I'm just too busy dancing, I'm just so happy, I'm so excited, oh, this is amazing. Well, I guess Taipu got the adventure he always wanted. These guys are really fun to watch. Again, you just the personality of this. This guy, he'll start banging his head. What the heck? I never noticed he had that watch until just now. And there he goes, head banging. And these guys will start doing random dances. And again, just the personality of this game is just insane. Even though you never see these guys open their mouths or anything, they're just so darn cute and endearing. And it's just, again, this game is just stupidly fun. I love it. This is why this is one of my favorite games. Oh, watch this. I think he'll do it. Come on. You can do it.
A few moments later.
There he goes. Ah, oh, that's just too cute. Then he just shakes his head like, oh, whatever. Poor Tamaru. He wants so badly to fly, but he just can't. He's like one of the most inept of the Le-Matoren. He's just another misfit, like us, and like Taipu. This is such a wonderful game. That's the perfect word to describe it. It's wonderful.
Traveler, it's good to see you again after all our adventures.
He can't even talk to us for a few seconds without jigging to the music.
Return to Tree Bright Le-Koro was so long hoped for in Darkwood Rama Hive. Take this flute song. It fits in the flute you found. Whatever you need from Sun-Soaring Le-Koro, play song and you will have it.
Well, thank you. Goodbye.
By bringing all the great masks of power to the Suva, it is given to Lewa a golden kanohi. Some legends say after the golden kanohi are found, there will come the Toa Kaita. But I do not know what this is.
Goodbye.
Goodbye, Traveler, and farewell.
It's been a nice open spot to do this in. See if it'll work. Now this, like the crabs, is intended to be an easier express means of getting around the island, so you don't have to click on a zillion places. Whereas the Oslo crabs aren't utilized that well, though, this is a great way to basically just teleport around the island. I love the personality of these things. They have a few different animations. Sometimes they'll tilt their heads, sometimes they'll shake around like they're just excited to take off. And we can go almost anywhere, except here. Watch. Nope. Yeah, but we can just go just about anywhere else we want to. Okay, so here we are right now, Le-Koro. There's Po-Koro. Yep. We just flew all the way across the island, just like that. Oh, come on, do I have to click on the key for it to work? Anyway, yeah, I think Le-Koro, just this whole adventure that we just had, is a good testament to why I love this game as much as I do. It just has such a huge mark on me, and I don't think Bionicle would have succeeded quite like it did if not for this game. I think this game is a huge part of just why people love Bionicle. I mean, this had some influence on how the movie turned out. The guy we're playing is now, he was in the movie. The movie made all sorts of references to places around the island and just to the characters that they knew people would have seen in this game. It was just great how they catered like that, because they knew that people loved this. Bionicle wasn't just a toy line, it was a culture, it was a world, it was alive. And, you know, something like Hero Factory, it can't resonate with people in the same way, because it didn't have quite the same kind of launch. I mean, just look at how Bionicle started. It had this old game, all these adventures, all these wonderful characters and everything, just all this personality, all these great memories. And then they had the Rahi sets, and then they had, you know, these chieftains, and they had the McDonald's Matoran, and then they had, what was it, that 15-in-1 model kit, just all that stuff. It's just, let's compare Hero Factory to that. Okay, you got six heroes, like, six villains, like a special edition set, a motorcycle, a ship, and that's it. It was so underwhelming by comparison. And like the game that they released, yeah, it was kind of fun, but you're just going around an isometric sort of room, just shooting at a bunch of guys, and that's it, that's all that happens. Compare that to this. Man, the kids of today, they are so... I feel bad for them. I'm gonna go into that just a little bit more. Just give me a sec, because there's something down here I want to show you. It's time we got moving with this game. I'm sorry, I'm tripping over my own words now. I'm kind of tired. But anyway, sorry about all my rambling. And now there's no sound at all. That rock over there, it's just a really subtle detail. Might not seem that important, but we haven't seen any other rocks around here. I mean, look. So, let's see. Wake one, and you wake them all. I love cryptic stuff like that. Anyway, like I was saying, I don't see how Hero Factory could resonate with kids the way that this resonated with kids back in the day. I know that there are kids who love Hero Factory. They do, but there isn't really much to love about it. Yeah, they got the TV show, but it's just super cheesy. It's not nearly as intriguing as this, at least in my opinion. But, like, I do like the Hero Factory toys. I even like the first line a little bit, as simplistic as they were. But you know, while I like the toys, I could say the same thing about Bionicle. I could say the same thing about the Slicers and the Robo-Riders, all of these buildable figures. But what really set Bionicle apart, besides just the toys, which are always going to be pretty good, no matter what they call them, this was Bionicle. This whole world to just let yourself be sucked into. It was so amazing. And look at that, we got light stones everywhere now. The whole place is much brighter than it was before. Isn't that wonderful? But anyway, yeah. You'll never see something like this again. For some reason, Lego just didn't put nearly as much heart into the launch of Hero Factory as they did Bionicle. And like I said, you know, I like these other lines. I think Bionicle would still do pretty well, and it would last for a good long while before they moved on to something like Hero Factory. But part of what made Bionicle so interesting, part of what made it so enduring and last as long as it did, was this. This world and this story and everything. Anyway, we still can't talk to him quite just yet.
Turoka, the mining guilds have hit an underground rock layer that they cannot break through. We fear the protodermis will run out if we cannot continue our digging.
How far does it run?
Shaft 3 and Shaft 8 have ceased protodermis mining because they cannot break through this rock layer.
That's the entire mining area.
Yes, Turaga. For all we know, the strata extends beneath all of Matanui, except perhaps the Mangai volcano.
Are you certain there is no soft spot to dig through, Captain?
We've been over every inch of the surface. There are no fractures, no fault lines, nothing.
How much remains of the surface deposits?
They're running out. We may have to look elsewhere for more protodermis. like Tawahi or Powahi.
What is the layer made out of?
Our prospectors believe it to be rock, but it has higher organic levels than any mineral composite we've seen.
Organic?
Yes, it seems to have more in common with an Usul crab shell than any normal stone strata.
Strange. I wonder what we will find if we break through.
Draga, I must have more men and more machines if we are to know. You must allocate more resources to the mining guilds.
Captain, I am doing everything I can. No one wants to see the protodermis run out, but Onu-Koro has many problems right now.
And then they just loop through that for a while. So yeah, this place still has some issues we need to resolve. This last thing I've saved for now, we were supposed to do it before going to Le-Wahi, because it was just part of this chapter of the game. But I saved it for later, because I always like to let this be one of the last things I do before moving on to, like, the third act, if you will. Just because it's so mysterious. So yeah, we're heading into the Great Mine right now, another just amazing set piece. You know, this has been changed in this build of the game, but I believe sitting on this cart, there used to be a Matoran who, like, if you click on him, he'd fall down, and then he'd just yell at you, like, "Hey!" in Matoran letters. And for some reason, they removed that. They removed a few things like that. I have no idea why. Wait. No, they didn't. I'm pretty sure he was here before I found all the light stones. Oh. And now he's really getting to work. Silly me. I should have shown that before fixing things up. Well, anyway, look at this. Like I said, the heart of the island. So yeah, we've only been through a few tunnels here and there. And it's debatable just how big this island is. Some people say it's just a few miles wide based on how long it takes to get around this place in the game. But I don't think this is an accurate representation of the scale of it. I think it's probably like a couple hundred miles wide, or at least a few dozen, you know? It's a pretty big place. But of course, there's only so much of it that we can see in this, as vast as places like this make it seem. But yeah, we've been through only a few tunnels connecting the villages, but this is where the Onu-Matoran really do their work. They spread, like, all throughout the island in all these crazy tunnels. And again, if this was, like, a new, remade game, I could just imagine rummaging through all these and going just wherever and grinding for stuff. Anyway, let's talk to this guy.
Have you brought word from Onua? Has he figured out how to get through this rock layer?
What word from Onua?
The mining captains have been trying to get Onua to give us more workers and machines. If we don't find a way through this rock, there won't be any more protodermis.
Who are you?
I'm the chief prospector of Mineshaft 8. We dig for protodermis and stone here.
What is rock? What rock layer?
At the bottom of Shaft B, the elevator goes down there. Onu-Koro has had real problems since we hit this strata. Can't dig through it or blast it. Not even Onua could claw through it. It's just too strong.
Wow, that guy we just saw beat Lewa. He couldn't make it through there. So, yeah.
Take care when...
Wait, Onu-Koro already said this. Huh. Goodbye.
Look out for Rai in the tunnels. It's dark down there.
Here, whatever. Going... up? That's not right. We're already at the... This thing's supposed to take you down on the first trip, but I guess it's just another bug. I am glad that none of these bugs really interfere, really impede you from playing the game. They're just annoying. Anyway, let's see just what this is all about. And again, I just love how isolating this place is. I have to wonder just how creepy and dingy this would have been if there were any light stones here. Let's talk to this guy.
That strange disc on the ground is the only feature this rock layer has. I'm not sure. No, I gotta come up with some interesting voice for this guy.
The strange disc on the
No. That's...
Whatever. That strange disc on the ground is the only feature this rock layer has. I'm not sure what it is. They look like astrological symbols. If I knew an astrologer, I'd sure have a few questions for him.
Who are you?
I'm a prospector for the mining guild. We're trying to figure out how to get through this rock layer and mine more protodermis and stone.
Wait, that guy up there already said that. Anyway, strange disc.
Yeah, so one on the ground over there. Did he just point to it as scratching himself? It's covered with strange symbols. We have no idea how it came to be here, buried so far underground and sunk into this hard rock. It's very mysterious.
I don't want an astrologer.
You do? Great! Take this message and deliver it. I've sketched out the disc. Maybe your friend can figure out if it means anything important.
Well, that was quick.
Goodbye.
Let's take a look at the disc real quick. So yeah, pretty cryptic. But clearly someone really advanced and made it. And now these guys have like dug so far into the earth that they happen to land here. I mean, look at this. This entire floor is like a completely different color than everything up there. Anyway, going up. So yeah, when I was a kid, this game just had a huge impact on me, and if it wasn't there, I don't know how interested I would have been in Bionicle. Like I said, I love the toys, but like I said, you could say the same thing about any kid who likes Hero Factory or liked the Slicers back in the day. Let's see how quickly we can get through here. Yeah, I think that might have been faster than the crab. Anyway, I'm gonna go to the boat at the other end of this desert. I just want to show what that place looked like going out. I love this view of the ocean. So pretty. But yeah, if Hero Factory had something like this, I think it would probably be even more successful. But the sad thing is, Hero Factory just doesn't have the same kind of rich lore or world that this does. I mean, in 2004, Metronui, that was amazing. Just the art direction, and just everything about it. Compare Hero Factory's Makuhiro Sei to that. Yeah, it's got all these crazy planets and whatnot. You could say it's kind of a mythos, I guess. But it's just so half-assedly slapped together, it isn't impressive or memorable in any way to me. It's just a bunch of random junk. It's like in Ratchet and Clank. Yeah, there's a bunch of different planets, but I only really care about a few of them. They're all fun, but not that many of them really stick out to me. Anyway. Let's see. Right. Strange. A prospector found this on Onu-Koro underground. Who would build a sundial underground? Perhaps there was an earthquake and it fell beneath the earth. Yes, this is an ancient sundial used many ages ago. I am certain that its purpose has been completely forgotten. The strange thing about it is that it is an indicator at 4 o'clock. No other sundials have this marking. I've always been curious as to why. Take this gnomon and see if it fits in the center of the sundial. You see, I found it in the foothills of Mount Aihu a long time ago, and since then I've been looking for the sundial to which it belongs. You may have found it for me. Man, when I first got to this part in the game, I shit my pants. Because it's like my mind just warped all over the island, like from here to Onu-Koro. I'm like, oh man, I can't wait to get back there and just solve this. If it is in a cave, then we may not find out what happened every day at 4. Unless you have some way to fake sunlight underground. Yes, I do. Goodbye. Again, I'm sorry if it seems like I'm shitting on Hero Factory. Like I keep saying, I like the toys. I haven't gotten any this year because they were crappy, but I'm at least gonna get Furno's Flying Mech in 2014. Huh? Something. But I'm not attached to the world of it like I was attached to Bionicle. I look at the trailer of, like, Invaders from Below and see how they're trying to make it so... Whoops. Wrong place. Wait, where should I go? I guess I'll go through Tawahi. Yeah, this seems like a good place to talk about this sort of thing. Again, I just don't find myself taking Hero Factory seriously. I get I'm not supposed to, it's just for kids, but hey, this was just for kids too. But it was still smart, it was still rich and interesting. But when I see the commercials for Invaders from Below, how they're trying to make it so serious and so epic, it is just completely lost on me. I'm like, yeah, sure, whatever. Because there hasn't been anything to, like, make me build a bond with the characters leading up to this or anything. It's just like a bunch of random crap. And I'm sorry, you know, like, Hero Factory's okay. But again, it just doesn't have any substance. And if this game wasn't here, I don't think Bionicle would have much substance either. Even this right here is just a toy commercial. That said, it's my favorite toy commercial. It's the greatest toy commercial I've ever seen in my life. And there'll never be anything like it again. It was truly a product of the time. They were just booming with passion for Bionicle. You could tell that they loved doing this. But you just don't get that same sense from Hero Factory. I didn't get the same sense from the Slicers or the Robo Riders.
Who knows, maybe whatever they make after Hero Factory, if they don't just give up on construction figures altogether, maybe that'll have the same passion that this did, or at least come close to it. Because, again, I just don't see that with Hero Factory, and it's honestly kind of sad to me. But it makes me feel lucky to have grown up when I did. It makes me feel lucky to have been at an age where I could really appreciate this back when it was just so great.
Yay, we solved it!
Looks like you had the right idea, stranger. That disc was a passage through the rock after all.
And, that's all there is to find down here. Just a golden mask with the word Rahi in front of it. Don't really know what that means. But I do recognize these symbols around it. I think it has something to know, I mean something to do with the Toa Kaida. Did we talk about that with Matau? Anyway, I don't see how we've helped these people at all. They're still not going to be able to mine any deeper than this for protodermis or whatever it is they need. This isn't some tunnel that leads to some secret cache or some precious mineral. They're still stuck. So, yeah, we may have gone like, I don't know, 10 feet or so deeper into the Earth. Not the Earth, whatever this planet is. Aqua Magna, yeah. But that's it. However, this mysterious thing will become relevant later in the story. Just not yet. But anyway, that was one of the last things we needed to do before moving on to like the next act of the game. So, I guess I'll get that done now. Anyway, again, this is my childhood, one of my favorite games, and I'm sorry I keep gushing about it. I keep saying the same things over and over again because I can't find the right way to say them. But I'll save those thoughts for the end of the whole thing. Two things I wanted to say. Recently, I found out that the Three Virtues, this group, one of my questions was featured in this interview of theirs with Greg Farshtey, the writer of most of the Bionicle books, who basically like took over the whole thing after a year or so, and wow. So yeah, my question that made it in there was if any of the higher reps gave him a hard time for making his stories. Whoops, I went past where I was supposed to go. Gave him a hard time for making his stories too violent, which I honestly found surprising that he said no. They were okay with whatever he wrote. There was this one time where he wrote about something they thought was going a little too far. I can't help but imagine what it might have been, but. He was never shut down by anyone else, and I thought that was really interesting, because Bionicle may seem just kind of innocent now, but you will be shocked by how violent it gets later on, especially in the online story serials. Anyway.
Thank you, adventurer, for helping with so many of Onu-Koro's problems.
There's the voice I was going for.
I thought the guildmasters would never leave me alone.
Who are you?
Like, now they have some peace. If there anything you would ask me, is I am Winua, Tarago of Onu-Koro. It is my job to keep things running smoothly around here. A hard task in these difficult times.
It's kind of funny. It's like, just people like Tarago and Onua, their heads are lower down so they don't have to make such big tunnels to fit through. It's just kind of funny. It's like an evolutionary thing.
Now that I have some peace, is there anything you would ask of me?
What is Onu-Koro? Even though I've been all over it by now and should know what it is.
Onu-Koro is the wondrous undercity of Matanui. Matoran come from near and far to trade at our great market and marvel at the work of our engineers. Stone dug from our quarries fuels the creations of Poe Matoran carvers. Protodermis, the stuff of life, is brought from deposits within the earth and traded amongst the Matoran. We also mine light stones and many other precious resources.
Who is Onu-Koro?
Onu-Koro is the Toa of our village. He is a great hero engaged on a quest to find the Masks of Power, which he will need to defeat the Makuta.
So, yeah. Well, goodbye.
Good luck in your travels, adventurer. May Onu-Koro protect you.
Again, just the lore of this place. Everything they added. Like, really, this... Just Onu-Koro alone adds so much. Anyway, I'm done gushing, I swear. I'm gonna move on to the next part of the game now. Yeah, it was nice that my question got in there. I'm gonna give a link to the Three Virtues in the description, so yeah, there's a shout out for you guys. Love your work. Yeah. Hope there'll be another Bionicle autopsy someday. That's just me.
Maybe they've already covered all the topics they want and they don't want to make anymore. I can understand. I've gone through similar things with certain projects I just didn't want to do anymore because, well, I'd said everything that I really needed to. Anyway.
Only guards may pass.
Dang it.